Hello, it's Tuesday, June 6th, 2017. You are listening to Inception Radio Network, voice of the fringe majority. This is Carol Carl with UFO Headline News. Where's the moon? Well, it's in the astrological sign Libra right now, but astronomically, there's other interesting stuff. Earthsky.org brings us this. Tonight finds the waxing gibbous moon passing in front of the constellation Libra the Scales. Just for clarity, those aren't scales as in lizard. They're scales as in balance, as in weight, of course. Although tonight's brilliant moon makes it fairly easy to locate Libra's place in the starry sky, that pesky, drenching moonlight will make it nearly impossible to see this rather faint constellation of the zodiac. With no first-magnitude stars to showcase this constellation, demure Libra fades from view on this moonlit night. However, the moon will drop out of the evening sky by about mid-month. That's going to give you a chance to view this constellation in a dark sky. In fact, you won't even need a pitch-black night to see Libra's two modestly bright stars. Buckle up, we'll try to pronounce them. Zubenelgenubi and Zubeneschamali. Oh, we can spell them. That's Zubenelgenubi and Zubeneschamali. Zubenelgenubi and Zubeneschamali. What a team. And as long as the sky's moderately dark, Libra's two brightest stars should be fairly easy to see. So these stars are easier to see than their names are to pronounce. Practiced stargazers know the constellation Libra is sandwiched between two first-magnitude stars, Antares and Spica. Despite tonight's moonlit glare, you might be able to spot Antares to the east of tonight's moon, Spica to the west of the moon. If you see these stars tonight, try to be mindful of where Antares and Spica reside in the sky this evening, and then use these stars to starhop to Libra later this month. And Bruce McClure, who writes this for earthsky.org, adds that, by the way, the star Spica is quite easy to locate at present because Jupiter, that brightest star-like object in the evening sky, is lodged relatively close to Spica on the sky's dome. But wait, 1 year from now, June 2018, Jupiter's going to pair up quite closely with that star Zubenelgenubi. So if Libra eludes you this year, you can count on Jupiter to show you this constellation of the zodiac in 2018. Bottom line, tonight, June 6th, 2017, use the moon to locate the constellation Libra's place in the starry heavens. Here's a headline from digitaltrends.com with a byline for Trevor Mogg. That's Mogg with two G's. Headline, Welcome Back. SpaceX's Dragon capsule makes history with its second visit to the International Space Station. Following its successful launch from the Kennedy Space Center in Florida on Saturday, June 3rd, SpaceX's Dragon capsule made history on Monday, June 5th, as it became the company's first spacecraft to connect with the International Space Station for a second time. Its arrival marks the first United States spaceship to return to the International Space Station since the Space Shuttle program ended in 2011. The Dragon first visited the space station in 2014, with this second trip serving to highlight the progress SpaceX is making with the design of its reusable rocket system, which also includes a Falcon 9 launch vehicle capable of landing back on Earth minutes after leaving the ground. NASA announced the historic revisit by the uncrewed Dragon on its website. Quote, while the International Space Station was traveling about 250 miles over the South Atlantic Ocean east of the coast of Argentina, flight engineers Jack Fisher and Peggy Whitson of NASA captured that Dragon a few minutes ahead of schedule at 8:52 a.m. Eastern Time, end quote. Now that it's in the firm grip of that inhabited orbiting satellite, the Dragon cargo ship will be carefully maneuvered by ground crew using the space station's robotic arm. They'll carefully install the capsule onto the Earth-facing port of the Harmony module before the astronauts begin unpacking nearly 3 tons of supplies and equipment. The equipment? Well, the science gear includes, of all things, a number of fruit flies for an experiment aimed at improving our understanding of the effects on heat, lengthy heat exposure in microgravity. NASA explained, quote, because they're small and they age rapidly and have a well-known genetic makeup, the fruit flies are good models for heart function studies, end quote. The crew will also be conducting tests focusing on osteoporosis as scientists search for ways to help astronauts maintain healthy bone density while they're in space for extended periods. If the research proves successful, these findings could lead to the creation of medication which can prevent bone loss and even build new bone, helping not only astronauts on future missions into deep space, but also millions of people back here on Earth currently dealing with that condition. In addition, three payloads inside Dragon's unpressurized area will demonstrate new solar panel technologies and study the physics of neutron stars and host an array of Earth-viewing instruments, according to NASA. The Dragon will stay locked and docked for the rest of this month before SpaceX embarks on its next challenge, bringing it back safely to Earth, where it's hoped they'll splash into the Pacific Ocean off the coast of Baja California. And after that, well, most likely another trip to the space station with more supplies. And here at UFO Headline News on Inception Radio Network, we will keep you posted. Here's an update on an update. It's concerning the WOW signal, that famous signal that astronomer Jerry Emmon found out of Ohio State University. It seems to have been a one-off, but here's a headline. The mystery behind a 40-year-old signal from outer space may finally be solved. This gets a byline for Avery Thompson, who writes for the Science Bureau of Popular Mechanics. On August 15, 1977, a radio telescope located at Ohio State University detected something strange. The telescope was scanning the stars, searching for possible signals from alien civilizations as part of the SETI project, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, and on that date it found something. The telescope recorded an incredibly strong signal appearing to come from somewhere in the direction of Sagittarius. The signal only lasted about a minute and was never detected again. This signal was so strong that astronomer Jerry Emmon, he spells that E-H-M-A-N, he first spotted it. He circled it in red pen and wrote WOW! Exclamation mark in the margin. The WOW signal, as it would come to be known, became the best evidence ever obtained for extraterrestrial life, at least until now. One astronomer believes he's figured out what really caused the WOW signal, and, spoiler alert, it's not aliens. Astronomer Antonio Paris has been studying the WOW signal for a long time. In 2016, he released a paper along with fellow astronomer Evan Davies. They suggested in this paper the signal could have been caused by a comet orbiting in the inner solar system. Specifically, the 2016 paper identified two comets by the names of 266P/Christensen and P/2008Y2Gibbs. These were both in the area where the WOW signal was detected. Both of these comets have large hydrogen clouds surrounding them that could produce that kind of signal, the one detected by Jerry Emmon in 1977. Antonio Paris spent about 4 months in late 2016 and early 2017 with a telescope pointed at comet 266P/Christensen and found strong signals of the same type as the WOW signal. And then Paris also examined several other comets. He found the same type of hydrogen cloud and the same type of signal, which means that even if comet 266P/Christensen wasn't the specific source of that initial WOW signal, another comet is most likely the culprit. Yikes. This is bad news for anyone holding out hope that the WOW signal would be aliens, but it seems to be a solid conclusion to one of the biggest mysteries in astronomy. Now that we know how comets can create these otherworldly signals, any future signals we get are going to have to be vetted much more carefully. This broadcaster still holds out hope that it's something other. From theexpress.com out of the United Kingdom, yes, we know the Express can get hyperbolic, but here's a story credited to John Aston. Headline, former governor of Arizona, aliens came to my state in UFO during the Phoenix Lights. Here we go. never-before-seen footage of Fife Symington, who was governor of Arizona from 1990 to 1998, reveals he was a witness to one of the world's biggest ever mass UFO sightings, and he believes it was extraterrestrial. The Phoenix Lights incident remains one of the world's most perplexing mass UFO sightings on record and still causes intrigue among the alien research community, even though many skeptics claim to have debunked the case. It became a phenomenon on March 13, 1997, when thousands of people reported seeing huge triangular UFOs drifting over Arizona and specifically the city of Phoenix. The size of these objects varied from Boeing 747 to multiple football field size. Fife Symington made the confession during an interview with UFO investigator James Fox back in 2006. But now, James Fox has released never-before-seen footage from that interview to coincide with the 20th anniversary of the sighting. In the newly released footage, Symington says he believes the UFO sighting was escalated up the chain of command. He said, quote, "Issues like this go up the chain of command all the way to the Pentagon. We called the Pentagon. I think they knew there had been sightings, but they weren't talking about it," end quotes. Mr. Symington described the official Air Force explanation that the UFOs were flares as, quote, "total bunk," end quotes. Symington said, quote, "I've seen high-altitude flares before. There is no way this was flares. It's never been explained," end quotes. During this new interview, James Fox said some people criticized Mr. Symington's own handling of that incident at the time. Yes, gentle listeners, if you recall, Mr. Symington held a press conference as governor and brought out one of his aides who was dressed in the most unlikely alien suit and said he found out who was the source of the Phoenix Light sightings. It was a big mistake, and he later realized that mistake and came forward, bless his heart, with his disclosure. Yes, he'd seen it too. And apparently, James Fox believes that this criticism of Symington's handling of the incident has prompted him to open up more about being a witness. Speaking of being a witness, let's go to ufostalker.com for a first-person sighting that occurred over Bradford, Pennsylvania. This is MUFON case number 84136. It's an older sighting. It happened on the 15th of July, 2016. It wasn't reported till the 2nd of June this year. Summary: sphere-like objects flying over house. Sighting specifics offer a viewing distance 501 feet to 1 mile. The altitude 500 feet or less. The sighting duration 2 minutes. Object features merely described as other. The flight path was a straight line path, and this object had a sphere shape. Here are the sighting details. In July 2016, at approximately 3:30 a.m., I was standing on my back deck, just hanging out, as I usually do when I go out late at night. I looked up into the sky and observed the stars, or the moon, both of them, because of my interest in astronomy. That particular night, the cloud cover was minimal, and the moon actually highlighted the cloud cover. As I stood looking into the sky, I happened to notice, not too far off into the distance, several perfectly round objects moving at a very slow rate of speed. They were approximately 500 feet in altitude. These things were also moving in a perfectly straight line, heading northeast from my position. They were flying in a horseshoe formation, and each sphere was equidistant from the other. I would say that distance was approximately 50 to 60 feet apart. I also noticed there wasn't any type of sound, any type of lights whatsoever, which I thought was also strange. As it moved closer, and I could get a better look, I counted 7 large spheres. As I watched it, I was wondering to myself, what the heck is this? As it continued to move closer, these spheres appeared to get larger. I would say each sphere could hold approximately 20 or more people inside. Now, what actually caught my attention as I was looking at it and wondering what this thing was, another sphere, the same size and same shape, came out of nowhere and placed itself in a perfect position on the right side of the horseshoe formation, flying at the same speed. The altitude and distance between it and the others completed a perfect horseshoe formation. I mean, the eighth sphere that came out of nowhere and perfectly joined in the rest of the formation meant that now I was counting eight spheres instead of seven. I live near an oil refinery, so I was thinking maybe the eighth sphere seemed to be collecting info or data on the refinery. I normally have a 3 million candle spotlight on the picnic table on the deck. That's where I normally stand to spot animals and such, which wander around at night. I just like to see what might be making the noises I hear. On this particular night, my spotlight was charging in the basement, and I hardly ever at all go out at night without it. This particular night, I wasn't lucky enough to have it near, and I couldn't grab it quickly enough to get a better look at this thing. The whole ordeal only lasted about a minute or less, and the thing was moving slow enough so that I was able to say it wasn't of this world. It wasn't a balloon, airplane, helicopter, nothing skeptics seem to say when you can't explain something. I really didn't have any type of feelings other than I wanted to know what this was, and after the fact, I wish I had had my spotlight to get a better look at it. I lost sight of the objects ultimately because I first sighted them from my deck at the back of the house. That deck is 8 feet off the ground. It doesn't extend far enough to be able to look completely around the corner to the other side of the house. If I'd wanted to keep an eye on this thing, I would have had to run through the house, open up the front door, normally locked, then unlock the second door to get outside, and by that time, and by the speed the thing was moving, I doubt I would have seen it again, so I didn't bother. I'd also like to add that prior to this sighting, I had a dream of encountering an alien. We were in a mountainous area. This thing had gray skin color, large slanted eyes, etc. There were mountain peaks with very little vegetation. We were looking at each other eye to eye. I had a feeling this object in the dream, this creature, was female. I tried to talk to her, but she never said a thing. She put her hand on my shoulder, and immediately I felt euphoric. It was as though all my concerns went away, as though 1,000 pounds had been lifted off my shoulder. What a strange dream. She kept moving over the mountains, and that's when I woke up. Strange, who knows? It sounds weird, and it was. And to end what was my ordeal with a UFO after that alien dream, I will say this. Everything that happened did happen, and I'm actually hoping it will happen again. I'd love to experience more and learn more about what's out there among us. Signed, Jeff. Jeff, thank you, and wouldn't we all like to know more about what's out there? Interesting dream, interesting connection? Let's go south and a little bit west now to the state of Kentucky, city of Lexington. That's the setting for MUFON sighting number 84042. The date of this sighting, also an older one, back to 2013, 9/20/2013. It wasn't reported till the 29th of May this year. Here's the summary. Silver, metallic, not polished, black rows of windows, oval shape. There's video, two clips, they're quite interesting, and you can find links to that later at ufoheadlinenews.com. In the category of sighting specifics, our witness offers a viewing distance that began at 501 feet and eventually extended to 1 mile. The altitude was over 500 feet without cloud cover. The sighting duration was only 10 seconds, but the witness was able to make out object features described as windows. The flight path, hovering, then path, and this object had an oval shape. There's a bit of weather. The maximum temperature in Lexington, Kentucky was 86 degrees Fahrenheit, 30 degrees Celsius. Minimum temperature, 67 degrees Fahrenheit, 19 degrees Celsius. The visibility factors, maximum 10 miles, 16 kilometers, dropping down to a minimum visibility of 7 miles, 11 kilometers. And at the time of this sighting over Lexington, Kentucky, it was raining. Here's the account. I was walking to my car to go to a meeting. It was around noontime. I opened the car door and looked up as I was preparing to get in. I saw a UFO stationary above me, next to a cloud. It was silver, metallic, but it wasn't a polished, shiny look. It had a row of black windows in the middle, straight across the craft. It was an oval shape. When I saw it, I said softly, "I see you. I caught you. I see you." And the next moment it went in a straight line into the cloud next to it. It was as if it was hiding from me. It felt very good to see this. I wasn't afraid at all. I felt like they were monitoring me, like they wanted me to see them. And the fact that I was going to a meeting associated with research and enlightenment, that was the reason I think they were so bold. It's like they knew where I was going. This sighting was daytime and as solid as a car. I never said anything to anyone, maybe just told a couple of people. I didn't think they'd believe me, and I didn't want to freak them out. So instead, I made a video to show the details. And I'm now coming forward for the record. I just wanted it out there. Thanks. Very interesting. The witness was on the way to a meeting, an association for research and enlightenment. Very curious. Perhaps one to toss into that conscious contact basket. Pretty soon we might need a bigger basket. Let's take ourselves now down to Quintana Roo, Mexico. What a delightful name. Quintana Roo, we'll spell it. Q-U-I-N-T-A-N-A. Second name, Roo, R-O-O. This is MUFON case number 84102. The date of this sighting is May 18th this year. It was reported on May 31st this year. Here's the summary. Reflective orb miles away, moved fast and erratic. There are photos and there's a video you can find later at ufoheadlinenews.com. Sighting specifics, viewing distance over 1 mile, altitude over 500 feet under cloud cover. This sighting duration was 3 minutes long. The object features are described as none. The flight path is described as other. And this object had a sphere shape. There isn't any meteorological report, and it's a short report at that, but it's vivid, so here we go. I was recently in Quintana Roo, Mexico, and on 5/18/17, I observed what appeared to be a metal object. This object was 3 to 5 miles off the coast, and it was moving in a very erratic manner. This thing wasn't like any known aircraft I've ever seen. A vivid reflection is actually what made me notice the tiny object. I watched the object for roughly 60 to 90 seconds before I began filming the attached video. I knew immediately this was odd. I called to my wife to come and look. And before I could turn the recorder back on, this object moved upwards and disappeared. I'm usually not out looking for videos to post, but I wanted others to see what I'd seen and judge for themselves. And you can bet we will do that. Also, gentle listeners, a reminder again, at the end of ufostalkers.com site reports, there's a place to leave your comments, your questions, and perhaps your confirmations if you happen to be wherever a sighting is reported and you saw it too. It's your chance to jump in and contribute. We can see we've got to jump out with our contributions because that's a wrap. Thank you for listening to Inception Radio Network. Follow today's broadcast at ufoheadlinenews.com. Loving kindness. Take care of each other. We're all in this together. This is Carol Carl. See you tomorrow.